discuss these, Sally and I are joined by Alpesh Patel from Profidium Partners. Alpesh, great to see you again.
Thank you.
The Guardian, and there he is, the man Mitt Romney. Let's try and get that picture back up on screen. The man who, with a big smile on his face, but I suppose the question is this the guy to beat Barack Obama?
Well, actually, it's a terrible result for him. You might think it's wonderful because he's won two consecutive...
Two out of two.
But actually,
not terrible.
The reason it's terrible...
None out of two would be terrible.
I used to work in the U.S. Congress. I like to think of myself as something of an expert in American politics.
You like to think of yourself
I'm now going to prove how little I know. But the fact of the matter is, all the other challengers now know who to attack. He's going to have no split in the spending amongst the four other runners who have all said they're going to continue with the race. None of them are going to be attacking each other because they know they've got one single target. Now, the last time a non-incumbent Republican won the first two primaries was 1976. How did that turn out for them? They didn't win the presidential race. And the reason for that is they're going to spend months attacking each other. All the Democrats and all the non-decides and all the Republicans are going to be watching this. And by the end of it, they'll have done the job for the Democrats.
Isn't that the purpose of the whole primary process? To toughen you up, to prepare you for a grueling presidential race?
But my point is, this is not how you want it to go. It's a long race, as Newt Gingrich has said. And he, although he came in fourth, don't really matter. He's just pulled in $5 million. Last Friday.
But then you say that. I mean, I remember the last time when obviously Barack Obama won, he had a long and drawn out and very difficult race against Hillary Clinton, and yet he won.
Exactly. He wasn't leading because Hillary Clinton was leading. So all the firepower against Hillary, and in the end, it dragged her down. And what I'm saying with this is, wait until we've got through about half the primary races and then have a look at Mitt Romney. They're going to go...
And how big that thumbs up.
They've gone for a guy who's in private equity, whose job is to create enterprises, and they've said, you're anti-capitalist. They can spin this around so badly, and I think there'll be a few skeletons coming out, because there always are with these things. Just give it a while.
But a quick question on all the candidates across the board. Are there any who you think have the kind of firepower to challenge the president, even though he has a very tough record to defend?
As the way things look at the moment, and I know this might seem an odd thing to say, don't rule out Newt Gingrich. I remember back in the mid-90s when he was Speaker of the House, he was a very charismatic, very able political player, and if it was one-to-one, the Republicans are going to have to move to the right because they're going to have to show themselves as being something quite distinct and different from the Democrats. That's their best hope. Being in the middle, fighting for the same turf, I don't think really going to get them anywhere because you'll just get the Democrats winning again. And a move to the right is definitely Newt Gingrich and it's not Mitt Romney.
All right, well, let's change the tone quite significantly now and talk about what's going on in Syria and the photographs on the front page of today's Independent, which shows you various people in various places within Syria listening to the speech of President Assad and him showing he is not going to change the situation there despite monitors being there, etc., etc.
No, he's saying he's going to change the situation. He's going to pretty much ensure more deaths. There's been 5,000 deaths. The leader is definitely promising more in his public speeches. And it's frankly incomprehensible and ununderstandable how Saudi Arabia, Kuwait just simply do not intervene. The other Arab nations don't intervene. And I don't understand why the Americans don't put a heck of a lot more pressure on their Arab allies like Saudi, like Kuwait, and saying, send the troops to the border and look for physical intervention.
But we don't know about what pressure's being put on, do we?
Well, clearly,
privately,
Not enough. Publicly,
it's a very different situation as to what will be said in the public arena.
I think we do know what pressure is being put on because you see it by the actions being taken. You send in a few monitors. The UN has said that as a result of these monitors, actually the number of deaths has increased.
In fact, there have been 400 deaths reported since they were in.
Which is actually worse.
But isn't it equally troubling that you talk about Saudi Arabia, but the big player there is also Turkey. And Turkey has made it clear that they have no stomach for any kind of Libya-style intervention. So for the meantime, it appears as though the international community's hands
Our friends and allies in NATO, you know, with friends like this, Saudi, Kuwait, Turkey, you wonder where the courage is going to come from to do anything.
Let's have a look at the International Herald Tribune, which is taking a different angle on the Greek debt crisis and looking at the winners in this scenario. And in fact, it talks about the hedge funds benefiting from a big payout in the Greek rescue. And this is referring to the fact that actually Athens is hoping to receive a lifeline, something along the lines of 30 billion euros from the EU and the IMF in the near future. And they're saying if they don't get it, Lucas Papademos, we could be seeing a disorderly early default in March. And so is this a recipe for those who are, you know, speculating in the markets to basically make quite a bit of money?
Hedge funds don't speculate. They take reasoned, sensible, risk-assessed judgments. What's essentially happened is that banks who have held these Greek bonds and were worried that a deal might not be done have sold them at, let's say, at an undervalue. They've sold them to hedge funds so that they can get their money quicker, avoid the risk of a worse scenario. And the hedge funds have said, well, actually, we think there's going to be payment made. We'll buy these because we're going to make a profit on them a little bit later. Takes two to trade. Absolutely nothing wrong with that. The banks get certainty and they get liquidity and they get money in their pockets. And I'm sure their shareholders are happy they're not holding that risk. And the hedge funds and their investors, who have a greater risk appetite, take a bit of the other side. I think, and the undertone with these types of things, whenever hedge fund mentioned, is that they're awful, evil people. And of course, they're not. They're lovely, angelic individuals.
What about this issue, though, that's pointed out in this article about the private sector involvement here and the issue of the haircuts and how much haircut they have to take, et cetera, et cetera. It's a very tricky scenario, and politically it was very tricky. It was part of the reason why France and Germany couldn't see eye to eye for quite some time.
The private sector will take a 50% cut, basically, in the money that they're going to receive, and they'll switch from short-term bonds to longer-term. In other words, the idea is you'll get your money, except you'll get it over a longer period of time if you're in the private sector, and you'll get half of it rather than all of it, which is better than nothing. And I think that's a very acceptable situation. I think the Greeks don't have a problem with it, of course.
Let's talk about the bankers who will make you an offer that you cannot refuse, according to a report in Italy published in The Telegraph. The Mafia is now the number one bank, in quotes, in Italy, with a liquidity of something like 65 billion euro.
Their cash reserves amounting to something like 7% of Italy's GDP.
Their profits, never mind cash, their profits, 100 billion euros. That's the 7% of GDP. Why aren't they running the country? Well, of course they are. But not only that, the Greeks need a bit of money. Go next door to Italy, ask the Mafia. I mean, of course, the interest rates are going to be a little bit higher, but if you want to run a country properly, you don't do it with laws, you don't do it with normal business practices, you do it with offer that you can't
Another
refuse.
Challenge for Mr. Mario Monti.
Now, well, on a serious note, it just means that, again, I'm sorry to sound as if I'm always asking for military intervention in things, but the Italians send in the army, the police can't do the job, they send in the army and say, right, we want the money.
Balling babies, send in the army.
You said it, not me.
Exactly.
Mom of three. Well, I did my own research on this, and as somebody who's been to the university there, and all I can say is, yeah, it really works. It works with nagging as well. It gets people to move faster.
Does nagging work? Well, that's a thought for you to reflect on. Alpesh Patel, thank you very much for coming in. That's our newspaper review from Sally and me.
Bye-bye.
Goodbye for now.
See you soon.